A massive search and rescue operation still underway in Miami. Extreme heat as temperature records fall left and right in the Pacific Northwest. And the woman who caused the biggest crash in Tour de France history still on the lam. Monday Need to Know. Let's go. Good morning. This is Cheddar's Need to Know podcast for Monday, June 28th. I am Jill Wagner with Carlo Versano. Carlo, good morning.
Wags, welcome back. How was your staycation?
It was very nice. I kind of feel like I need another vacation, as happens after when you go on certain vacations or staycations. But it was nice. And thanks to you and Baker for holding down the fort.
Always count on Baker for pitching in at the last minute.
We have to be careful because I feel like he's really good, and I think he really enjoys it. So I think that we kind of need to watch our backs and maybe limit the vacations.
That's a good point. You're right. Baker's coming for us.
All right, let's start with this horrific news out of Florida. This Miami condo collapse, the death toll's now risen to 9, with more than 150 people still unaccounted for. The last person to be pulled from the rubble alive was that happened on Thursday. So hopes have now started to fade a bit for those that are still missing. The Washington Post is reporting that an engineer had warned back in 2018 that he had seen, quote, major structural damage to a concrete slab below the pool deck of the Champlain Towers South Building. And it clearly had not been fixed at the time of the collapse.
The, you know, tragedies like this, so alarming for, I think, two reasons. One, just because of how preventable they are, right? And two, just how we in America seem so ready to sort of accept them as part of life here, even though this kind of thing just shouldn't happen. It shouldn't happen anywhere, but it sure as heck shouldn't happen in the United States of America in 2021. It's sort of similar to mass shootings in if that makes any sense. At least that's sort of how I think of it. You know, Britain did a national inquiry after the Grenfell Tower fire in 2017, that big fire at that public housing complex in London. It killed 70 people, so probably will end up having been a smaller death toll than this. There's not going to be any sort of inquiry here, at least on a major level, I don't think. I don't think this will be any sort of galvanizing tragedy in America. I think most people will probably forget about it after a few days or a couple of weeks. And it's just so sad. It's, you know, it's still unclear where the blame lies here. Was this a systemic lack of regulation? Was it the effects of climate change on our infrastructure, a lazy inspector or a greedy developer, or something we don't even know? Or some combination of those things, right? I think the story in the Washington Post suggests that this was entirely preventable if they listened to this engineer, although we still have to find out more.
And the victims here of this disaster really reflect Miami's very diverse international population. You have South American immigrants, yeah. Orthodox Jews, foreign retirees among those killed or missing. Israel says as many as 20 of the missing residents were citizens of that country. Another two dozen from Argentina, Paraguay, Uruguay, and Venezuela. There is a significant Latino Jewish population impacted here. For example, the Venezuelan Jewish community, not big, but a very tight-knit group of expatriates that live in that area. So it's one of those things where, at least on social media, and you're seeing people say everyone kind of who lives around there knew someone or who lived there or their friend or cousin, if not a direct relation. Israel has now sent search and rescue teams, as has Mexico. Important to note at this point, there is still hope. Crews are still holding out hope that they might find some of the survivors. This is not being called a recovery operation at this point. But adding to the challenge, there's been a ton of rain in the past few days. There's also been fires in the rubble. And so it's just a painstaking process and torturous, of course, for the families who are waiting for any news about their loved ones.
Yes, some of those families allowed to visit the site over the weekend as those search and rescue operations continued. The operation going very slowly, the rain being one reason. But just how, you know, obviously it's extremely dangerous and perilous in the sort of situation. You don't know what else could collapse. You don't know what you're breathing in. I mean, I hate to compare this to the World Trade Center, and I don't mean to compare them at scale, but it is sort of similar in what those people were dealing with after those buildings collapsed, right? Trying to dig through that rubble. When the Hard Rock Hotel collapsed in New Orleans in 2019, it took a year for the final victim of that tragedy to be identified. And that was a building that was under construction and not filled with people. So this is going to be a very long and painstaking process.
And by the way, the building complex has another tower that was built the exact same way during the exact same time period. So the mayor is advising the residents there to evacuate as well. And when you talk about just what caused it, again, we still don't know. But you've got to imagine that a lot of those buildings, if you were living nearby, what you must be thinking right now just in terms of your own safety.
It's amazing to me that that other tower hasn't been, like, he's advised people to evacuate, the mayor, but they haven't told them to. I can't believe you people would actually stay in that building right now. That seems crazy to me.
It is, and it does seem crazy, but for many people, especially who are older, where do you go? You know, people may not have anywhere to go. Hotels are expensive. I don't know. I mean, I agree with you. It's like you would say, I'm out of here just for safety. But this points to part of the problem in terms of, you know, a lot of people not mobile and things
sure.
like that. So hopefully, hopefully we'll get some good news.
Let's hope
today.
For a miracle.
Any survivors and. Switching gears, Portland recovering from the hottest day ever recorded in the city. We are talking 112 degrees, breaking the record of 108 set a day earlier amid an unrelenting heat wave that is still baking the Pacific Northwest. So Seattle hit 102. That is a new record for June. Canada recorded its highest temperature ever, 115 degrees in a town in British Columbia. More records are expected to fall today. The Northeast also seeing the mercury rise this week, although not anything really compared to what's been happening out west.
Yeah, I mean, this has been a really hot June out here. Not, again, the Pacific Northwest is a whole nother ballgame, but it's amazing this summer already. It's only June 28th. There have only been 5 days in Seattle's recorded history where it's hit 100 plus. Two of them were this weekend. Another one will certainly be today. So I don't know if it's just me, but my existential climate dread has been quite high at the moment. So I don't know if anyone else is feeling that way. I don't know really what you can do about it, but it feels very potent. But on that note, I do have just a little recommendation. Here. If you're a peasant like me who still uses window air conditioners because you live in an old building, we bought a new air conditioner for this apartment, and I just want to recommend it because it's excellent. It's called the Medea U Inverter, and it's sort of like a mini split unit. It's expensive. It's like $500, but well worth it. Our utility bills are already down. It's been cooling off the place really well. So again, If you have central air, you don't need to worry about this kind of stuff. But in a place like New York City is a city where even billionaires can still use window air conditioners, right?
It's true. But on that note, one of the issues in the Seattle area, for example, is that very few people actually have air conditioners.
Yeah.
It's not, and especially in Canada, too. So when you're talking about these really extreme temperatures, it just adds to the danger for a lot of people. It's like, where do you even go? And then when it's so many days upon days on end, your apartment never cools off, as we've talked about.
Right.
You know, you never get that kind of like nighttime cool or whatnot. So,
and I read a story I'm sorry to interrupt you. No, I was just gonna say I read a story in one of the Seattle papers this weekend about how all the hotels in the area are booked solid because they have air conditioning. So they've been obviously, you know, really hurt during COVID. So they're having, you know, a real nice resurgence here, but only because they have AC.
It's like the law of unintended consequences. It's just you could not make any of this up. Breaking overnight, President Biden ordered airstrikes against Iranian-backed militias in Syria and Iraq that the Pentagon said had been using drones to attack U.S. targets in Iraq in recent weeks. It is the second time this administration has carried out bombings in the region.
Yeah, so these militias backed by Iran have been launching these small drones. I don't know if we talked about this before. It's fascinating what's going on here. They're launching these really small drones, like the kind that you'd see with, like, a photographer use, but they fill them with explosives, and then they have them dive bomb into their targets on the ground in Iraq, like CIA facilities where U.S. Special Forces are. Now, no Americans have been injured in these attacks. That's probably on purpose, I think, because the Iranians don't want to start a war, but they're just trying to sort of make some noise. The Pentagon, though, is said to be very concerned about this relatively new sort of low grade, but still very technically advanced form of warfare out there.
Look, it's not the same, but it's a similar idea as to what we were seeing Hamas do with Israel, which was send those incendiary balloons. And they look like balloons. This was a couple weeks ago. They look like balloons that you'd see at a kid's birthday party. And you're kind of like, what kind of damage is that going to do? But then they blow up. And they set fires, and they, you know, so it's quite dangerous. And, you know, we talk about what warfare is going to look like in the future. Unfortunately, it's getting easier to cause some destruction, and you even go cyber warfare, you know, and put that in and think about how damaging that would be as well.
The drone stuff really scares me.
The what does? The cyber stuff?
I was just going to say, like, now, the cyber stuff too, but the drone stuff is really scary. I mean, I just think about, like, what's going to happen? Like, what if eventually it seems to me like somebody's going to be assassinated via a drone, right? And not necessarily here, but somewhere in the world. And what's going to happen? That, like, there's not a lot you can do about drones, at least that I know about.
No, you make a great point. It's like it's there's too many places that you could get through. And if you think about the president, right, you're, and I don't know much about how security works, but you'd think that if they're pretty safe, if they're guarded on all sides by security, but not so. Former President Trump held his first rally since the one that led to the riot at the Capitol, going to Ohio to endorse a challenger to a GOP congressman who voted to impeach him. The event was more or less what you would expect, a lot of grievances, enemies, talking about his enemies, et cetera. But it came amid reports that Trump's family business may be indicted in New York as soon as this week.
That was really, it's more of a revenge tour, I think, than any sort of like coherent political comeback, just having watched some of the clips from that rally on Saturday night. But I do want to also just make a quick note here. This interview in The Atlantic yesterday with the former Attorney General Bill Barr, in which Barr broke with Trump by calling the claims of election fraud, quote, bullshit. Barr sort of probably trying to rehabilitate himself here. I think he probably needs a job. And I think a lot of the people who were in the Trump administration, at least at the end, are having a hard time finding jobs because of what happened at the Capitol. But what he said is important here, because this is the Attorney General at the time saying that he knew at the time that the whole voter fraud thing was BS from Jump Street.
It is incredible and definitely worth reading that interview for sure.
Yeah, it's good.
To the pandemic now, Sydney, Australia, under a new 2-week lockdown in response to rising cases fueled by that Delta variant, the variant continuing to make up an increasing percentage of the new cases seen here in the U.S., particularly in the rural South where vaccination rates are low. Both the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines continue to be extremely effective against that Delta strain, although there's not enough data on the J&J vaccine right now to conclude how well it's working against that mutation.
Did you see this thing that came out from the WHO on Friday that they said that even vaccinated people should still wear masks because of the Delta variant, even though the vaccines, at least these two vaccines, provide excellent protection against that mutation? I was really struck by that. And I mean, I hate to break it to the World Health Organization, but that's not happening. I don't think that there's never going to be another mask mandate anywhere in the United States, at least. And I think putting that sort of memo out there, I really don't think it helps the task at hand, which is getting these pockets of areas that aren't vaccinated vaxxed up, right? It's, again, the Delta variant is not a concern if you are vaccinated. It is a concern if you are unvaccinated. That's just, you can't say that enough.
We are hearing, though, a lot of the doctors that I follow on social media have been talking about the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, saying that if you might need actually a booster shot, either from Pfizer or Moderna, if you have that J&J vaccine, just because of this new variant. And they're actually begging the CDC or the World Health Organization or someone to put out a little bit of guidance, given that especially here in the United States, there's plenty of supply. So if you got the Johnson & Johnson vaccine and they don't feel like it's going to be effective against the Delta variant, which is likely going to become the most dominant strain, you may as well go ahead and get yourself that booster shot ASAP. Too soon to know, right? Like I'm saying, this is just keep this in mind. It's something to watch in the next couple of weeks. But potentially that could be one of the answers here. All right. We're also going to start doing some Olympic bulletins as we get closer to the opening ceremony, which is now less than a month away. Serena Williams, the latest top athlete to say she is not going to Tokyo. Williams is not going to tell reporters. She would not tell reporters, at her pre-Wimbledon press conference why she has decided to sit out the games this year. Although she said that previously that travel restrictions would prevent her from taking her three-year-old daughter Olympia with her.
Yeah, I don't blame her. In gymnastics, the trials are complete in St. Louis. Team USA is set for Tokyo on both the men's and the women's side. So just quickly here on the men's side, Sam Mikulic, he's going to lead the men's gymnastics team. This is the third Olympics for the six-time national champ. He's sort of the veteran of the squad. He's joined by, joined by Brody Malone, Hugh Muldaur, and Shane Wiskus. And on the women's side, Simone Biles obviously is going to lead five first-time Olympians to Tokyo. Denise Lee, Jordan Chiles, Grace McCallum, Jade Carey, and Michaela Skinner join her on the roster. They're the obvious overwhelming favorite to win gold as a team. The thing is going to be to watch is whether they will outmedal that incredible 2016 team just in terms of individual medals. I forget what that record was, but it does look like this team may be good enough to match it.
Well, I am very excited for gymnastics. to watch.
That's the only thing I think I'm excited for is just to watch Simone Biles. Some of these tracks.
You say that now, but you know what? I tend to think NBC does a pretty good job building up the storylines for a lot of the athletes. When you could devote a full night to watching, you do get very invested in who's, you know, in the athletes that are out there. But we shall
see. I'll probably get invested. I mean, I think that's always what happens. I'm like, oh, the Olympics again this summer, and I don't really care. But then after you watch a couple of those like glossy Bob Costas hosted, montages, you're like, all right, I am so sold on this. Let's go, America.
Exactly. And finally, the most wanted person in France, the woman who accidentally caused the biggest pileup in Tour de France history, still at large from both police who want to question her and the tour itself, which actually wants to sue her. Sign Lady, as she's become known on social media, was holding up a cardboard sign for a TV camera when German cyclist Tony Martin rode right into it, causing a domino effect that left dozens of riders piled up on top of each other during the first stage of the race. Carlo, I'm not sure if you saw the video, but it's like terrifying and incredible at once.
Amazing video. I'll throw it in the newsletter today if you haven't seen it. But first of all, why do they ride so close to each other? It seems like they're asking for trouble with that. I don't know. I'm not a cyclist expert, but maybe just space it out a little bit. But seriously, though, I mean, throw this woman in The Hague or better yet in the Bastille, because just unbelievable. I mean, just Jill, you think you had a bad weekend? At least you didn't ruin the Tour de France, right? Seriously, though, I shouldn't joke. I mean, 21 riders were injured, some of them seriously. There were head wounds. Some of these riders had to go to the hospital. The race is 2,100 miles, so it's not like you can just put up barriers along the entire route. I saw a lot of people on social media being like, why don't they just pen these people in? It's hard to do it when you have a 2,000-mile race, right? So you just have to assume that people aren't going to be idiots. But you know what they say, Jill, about making assumptions, right?
Very true. And also, one of the athletes that was in the race made the point of like, you know, they want the fans, because it's been the past year and a half. There have been races and events without fans. Yeah. And it is part of the event. And it's just nice that fans are allowed back. But just, man.
Everybody has
man.
Lost their minds. I mean, you saw it in the NHL. They're throwing beer cans on the ice. In the NBA, fans have had to be ejected from games for acting like idiots. It's like everybody really just needs to cool their jets a little bit. Everyone's just like post-COVID freakout central here.
I think everyone behaved at Bruce Springsteen's show. He's back on. He opened Broadway. And I'm super psyched about it. Springsteen on Broadway took the stage over the weekend for the first time. So at least the reviews were some semblance of normalcy.
The reviews were excellent, by the way. And he even joked about his getting his DUI this summer. He was just
What did he say? He
was just like, I hope everyone had a good summer. Like, you know, me having to spend a night in jail for drinking two shots of tequila on the beach. It sounds like it was very funny. Yeah.
All right, everyone. That is what you need to know for Monday, June 28th.
Have a good one, guys.